Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Have us to learn. So Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here this morning, Lord. We don't take it for granted that we get to come into your house and to worship you freely without persecution. Lord, we don't come to hear from a man, to hear from a woman. Lord, we don't come to church for tradition or ritual or even entertainment. We come to hear from you. And we fully acknowledge that it's Jesus Christ that's the senior leader of this church. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, would be our counselor. Lord, I pray that you would guide us and lead us and direct us out of your word this morning, that we would leave the church service and be your church to the lost and dying world that needs to hear of your goodness and your salvation. So, Father, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. We don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but rather as co-laborers in the body of Christ. So, Father, we thank you for all the churches across the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ today. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. Lord, we thank you for our Catholic brothers and sisters and all of the denominations that are preaching Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Lord, we ask that you would lift them up. Lord, our local churches, we thank you that your Holy Spirit would pour out on them, Harvest and the Grove. And Lord, we ask that you lift up Sandals and Water of Life, Ecclesia, Emmanuel Baptist, Victory, Trinity. Lord, we thank you for New Creation and Oak Valley, Abundant Living, all the churches across the Inland Empire, our Calvary Chapel brothers and sisters, Lord, that you would bless them as you have blessed us. And Lord, we thank you that we are all brothers and sisters in Christ working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So to you be the praise, to you be the glory, to you be the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
Amen.
Well, as you're taking your seats, get your Bibles out. If you've got your Bible on your device, get your device out. Whatever it is, your phone, your Kindle, your iPad, your Bible, whatever. Get your Bible out. You're going to need your Bible today. We're going to do some studying out of the Word of God. And if you've got your Bibles, go with me to Hebrews chapter 11, number 1. We've been in a series since the beginning of the year called Defining Faith. And here we've been looking at the subject and the topic of faith, defining what faith is, and now looking at also how faith begins to define who we are. And it's been a great series. I can't believe we're already in part number 6. If you've missed any of the previous weeks, that's okay. The premise or the idea and the teaching of faith is actually very simple to understand, because if it wasn't easy to understand, we wouldn't do it. And if we didn't do it, we wouldn't be pleasing God, because the Bible says it's impossible to please God without faith. So it's real easy. You can always go online, or you can get the CD outside at the CD sales counter. You can go online and listen or watch as well. And I want to encourage you to go back and think about that. We're going to continue in part number 6 today. And we're going to talk about what we want to talk about, or the subject of the fight of faith, or the faith fight. But looking at Hebrews 11th chapter, verse number 1, it says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for." It's the evidence of things not seen. And we've been looking at this verse defining faith, looking back, and I'll just give you a real quick recap of what we've discussed, because it's very easy. The first week we discussed, what is faith? Faith is what we believe. How do we get faith in week number 2? We get faith by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God, and then accepting it as the truth. The third week, we realize that we can't just hold on to our faith and expect it to do something, that we've actually got to release it or put our faith to work. So our faith must be released. We learn that if we release our faith, we also have to feed our faith in order for it to grow. So our faith must be fed. And last week, as we discussed, that our faith must be what leads us in what we think and what we say and what we do. Learning to be led by faith. And this week, we're going to talk about the fight of faith, or the faith fight. You know, growing up in the Cobray household, many of you know, if you know Pastor Jim, he'll just say, you know, let grandpa tell you like it is. I don't care what you think about me. He's kind of in your face. My family in general doesn't shy away from confrontation. You know, we have loud dinners, and if there's an issue, we always just like to hash it out. But growing up in the Cobray household, I was always kind of the opposite. I was the kind of one that, like, I didn't want to talk about my feelings. I didn't want to deal with the confrontation. I'd rather just kind of skirt around it. Let's all just kind of work it out on the inside and be okay with that. Sometimes that works, sometimes that doesn't. But you know, the thing is that in every one of our walks, whether we're Christian or not, we're all going to fight a battle, a spiritual battle. You know, you might say, well, hey, listen, when it comes to spiritual fights, I say, bring it on. Come on, devil, I got you. Some of you are like me. You're saying, I don't want confrontation. I don't want to fight. I don't want to get into this Christianity thing to go into another fight. I've already got enough battles in my life as it is. I don't need another one. But the truth of the matter is that regardless of who we are, regardless of what we believe, we will all on this earth face spiritual battles. Jesus tells us that the thief, the devil, comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So regardless of whether or not you're a Christian or not, you will still face spiritual battles and oppositions from the devil to try to steal you, to steal your joy, to kill your life, and to destroy your happiness. But I'll tell you what, we've got a spiritual fight ahead of us at some point in our life. Some of you might be going through it right now, and that's okay. But the Bible gives us some great encouragement as to what happens for our lives. The book of Romans tells us that we are more than conquerors. We don't need to shy away from the fight of faith or this faith fight, but rather to understand what the Word of God has for us and what the Word of God teaches us in regards to our spiritual fight so that we can live a life that the Bible promises us, a life of fulfillment, a life of abundance, a life that we are more than conquerors, a life of victory because it has already been paid for by Jesus Christ. So today we're going to talk about this subject of the faith fight. If you've got your Bibles, I want you to go with me to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians in the 6th chapter. It's actually a very familiar section of Scripture here. And as we get there and as you see the visual illustration behind, I'm sure many of you are saying, I already know where he's going. I like it where I'm going. Some of the staff at the church, as they were seeing what was getting collected all throughout, they were like, oh, I can't wait. But today we're going to look at this section of Scripture and we're going to really get deep into this. Now, sometimes when we teach, it's very easy. It's very basic. It's very common knowledge. And sometimes we get deep. Sometimes we preach messages where it's like, man, I just want to wave my hanky and praise God, hallelujah, amen. And sometimes it involves a lot of thought. And today is one of those messages for you and I that's going to involve a lot of thought. But you know what? I know you're smart. I know you can do it. I know you can stay with. And I know that if you grab a hold of what we're going to talk about today, it really will begin to change your life. I don't want to be cliche. Oftentimes preachers say, oh man, this message is going to change your life. This message is going to change your life. And this message is going to change your life. But I truly believe when we get a hold of the subject and the concept of faith like we're discussing today, it really will bring about the change in your life that you so desire to see. And it begins with the subject of faith and now continuing in this topic of the faith fight. So Ephesians in the 6th chapter, beginning in verse number 10. Verse number 10, this is the writings of Paul to the church at Ephesus, which we'll see that in a moment. We'll talk about why I said that. But in verse number 10 of the 6th chapter, it says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles or the devices of the devil. For we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand evil, the evil day, having done all to stand. Verse number 14, where we get really familiar, it says, therefore, take up the whole, or verse number 14, stand having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod or covered your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith with which you were able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. See, what happens is, and what we're reading here is Paul is talking about the fight, the spiritual fight that we are going to face. We're all going to get there at some point, whether you want to or not, whether you run from it or not, there will be a spiritual fight in your life. And so Paul is using combat terminology, talking about this warfare, this fight, this battle that you and I are going to have. But he says a couple very important things. First and foremost, he says, listen, we're not fighting against people. Our argument, our battle, our fight is not against people. Although it may seem as though people are who or what we are fighting, Paul the Apostle says our fight is not physical, it is a spiritual fight. We fight against the principalities of darkness, the god of this age, the powers of this age that are trying to destroy our lives. We have a spiritual fight. And so he says, take up the armor, and he begins to describe and gives this analogy of the armor using Roman armor. Now, I've got here on the stage some Roman armor. I've actually got the ensemble that a Roman soldier that Paul is talking about. I've got the ensemble here for you to see so that we can get a clear picture of what Paul's talking about. So Paul says, take up the armor of God. Put the helmet of salvation. So here we've got this real, this is real too. This is like the heavy. I'm not going to put that on. I'll mess up my hair. He says, take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. And what happens is we get real familiar with Ephesians chapter 6. We've probably all been there where we've heard the message talking about what the armor of God does. And they're real great messages. I mean, I tell you, real impactful, real powerful, real strong, looking at the armor of God, breaking it down into Paul's analogy of the Roman armor. But what happens is, as we begin to focus on the illustration, more so on the message, and what happens is we begin to make absolute statements about Paul's illustration here out of Ephesians, the sixth chapter. I remember as a little kid, my mom bought me that plastic armor from Berean. It had a helmet and it said salvation. It had a breastplate and it said righteousness. And it had a shield that said faith and a sword. And I would go outside and whack everything and pretend to play. And we'd wear that. And we begin to make these statements about this armor based out of Ephesians, thinking things like, well, Paul the Apostle says, take up the breastplate of righteousness. And here's a Roman breastplate. Now, this was actually molded to me. This is what I look like. Bible says, speak those things that are not as though they are. Hallelujah. So Paul says, take up the breastplate of righteousness. So we look at the illustration. We look at the example of Paul saying the breastplate of righteousness. And we look at this and we say, well, the breastplate covers my heart. Therefore, righteousness guards my heart. The helmet of salvation, the helmet covers my head. Therefore, salvation protects my mind. Or cover your feet with the gospel of the preparation of the gospel of peace. Therefore, when I walk, I got to walk with peace, and the peace protects my feet. And we get this this illustration. We begin to make these absolute statements like righteousness guards my heart, salvation my mind. And that's not wrong to say that, but I want to take you somewhere with me. I want you, if you could, would you leave a thumb or a ribbon, or if you've got your device, maybe bookmark it or something. Leave a bookmarker there in Ephesians chapter 6 and go with me to the book of 1 Thessalonians in the 5th chapter. 1 Thessalonians in the 5th chapter is written again by Paul, this time to a different church in a different city as well as a different time. Actually speaking, 1 Thessalonians was written about 10 years before the book of Ephesians was written, or the letter to the church at Ephesus. And Paul the Apostle is speaking to a different church at the time, and he speaks up to the church and now to you and I, saying in verse number 8 of chapter number 5, Paul says, but let us who are of the day be sober, be clear of thinking, putting on the breastplate of faith and love. And as a helmet, the hope of salvation. Wait a minute. I thought that righteousness was my breastplate. But now, in 1 Thessalonians, Paul says my breastplate is faith and love. What happened? Did they miss it? Did they translate it wrong? Some translations have even gone so far as to remove the word breastplate from this and replacing it by putting on the armor of faith and love so that there wouldn't be a contradiction in the Bible. But you see here, even if that's the case, nowhere in Ephesians 6 when Paul lists the armor of God does he mention the armor of love. So when we make these absolute statements that that righteousness covers my heart because the breastplate covers my heart, then we look at 1 Thessalonians, and all of a sudden we see what we would call a contradiction. But it's not a contradiction, because here's where I'm saying, or where I'm going with this. That Paul the Apostle did not remain true to his illustration of the armor of God. And if Paul the Apostle didn't remain true to his illustration of the armor of God, then neither should you and I make absolute statements about Paul's visual illustration. He was making a picture, just like you and just like right now, how I've got the armor behind me to show you, to say, this is what it looks like. Paul is making an emphasis here, and when we make the statements or we focus, because humanity, we like to make things better than the other. The disciples, they argued over who would be the greatest disciple. The church in the early ages argued what was the best gift of the Holy Spirit, and they wanted that one. We like to find something and make it the best. Oh, I like the shield. That's my favorite. Or I'm going to take the sword, and that's the one that I need. But Paul has a bigger picture in place or in mind for you and I. So with that in mind, let's go back now to Ephesians, the sixth chapter. Let's go back to Ephesians in the sixth chapter. And here's what I'm going to do. With the thought in mind that Paul didn't remain true to his illustration, I'm not going to do what Revelation says. I'm not going to take anything out of the Word of God or add anything to it. But for illustrative purposes, let's just remove the title that Paul puts of Roman armor. Let's just remove all of the visual illustration of the Roman armor and see what Paul says in Ephesians, the sixth chapter, beginning in verse number 14. He says, "Stand therefore with truth, having put on righteousness and the gospel of peace," or the preparation of the gospel of peace, "above all, faith and salvation and the word of God." Because what happens, we make these statements that it's all about the shield, it's all about the sword, it's all about the breastplate, it's all about the helmet, and we put blinders on when Paul is saying, there's a bigger picture that I want you to get. And the bigger picture starts back in verse number 11. Verse number 11, Paul the Apostle tells us, he says, "Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." Again, in verse number 13, Paul says, "Taking up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day." Listen, it's not wrong to hear a message about the shield and the sword and the belt. There's nothing wrong with that, but we cannot let ourselves get into absolute statements saying that the righteousness only guards my heart, because here's the reason why. Not one piece of armor will ensure Christian success, but the whole thing together. It's not one piece of armor that ensures success, but the entire armor, the bigger picture. Paul says, take up the whole armor of God. You know, I think back to the 90s when Arnold Schwarzenegger was real big in the movies. You remember those movies when he was the commando in the late 80s and whatever it might be? And you always get this image that here's Arnold and his shirt's all ripped because he's been beat up, but he's coming back and he picks up his gun and it only has like 3 bullets left in there, and he goes running out. He doesn't have any other armor and everybody's falling to his side and bullets are flying all over the place, and Arnold comes running out, "Get to the chopper!" And he takes his gun. And with his 3 bullets, this gun never runs out, and he kills all the 300 enemies. And we kind of get that, you know, I'm going to be the spiritual commander where I don't need the armor. I just need the shield or the sword. And I'll take the sword and I'll jab at the devil and I'll come swiping and whatever it might be. And we want to elevate one over the next. But you see, it's not one piece of armor that ensures success, but the entire armor together. Nobody going overseas to Afghanistan or to Iraq or any of those places would want to go armed with just safety goggles. Well, once you get over there, if you can find a weapon, you know, grab it, that'd be great. Nobody wants to go into war, despite what movies or we might think about the heroes and the Tom Cruises and so forth and so on. Nobody wants to go into a fight underarmed or underprepared. But you see, Paul's emphasis here is it's not just one piece. It's the entire armor of God. So what is this armor of God like we saw out of Ephesians? You know what? For the sake of the complete picture, let's add 1 Thessalonians 5:8 in the armor that Paul lists in there. The armor of God is truth. It's righteousness. It's the gospel of peace. It's faith, salvation. The armor of God is the word of God, of hope and love. And Paul says to put on the whole armor of God so that you can do the things that Ephesians, the sixth chapter, tells you to stand, to withstand the devices or the wiles of the devil, to stand in the evil day. What's the evil day? How about that day the doctor gives you the report that is contrary to the word of God? How about the day your kids look like they're going south? How about the day when the economy tanks? How about the day when everybody around you is falling to your left and to your right, but you can stand? Why? Because you have the whole armor of God. So we look at the physical armor and we say, well, I understand. I mean, if I want to put on a helmet, I put it on my head. And if I want to put on a breastplate, I put it on my chest and the shield I hold and so forth and so on. How do I put on spiritual armor? Because physical armor in a spiritual fight doesn't make any difference. So how do I put on the armor of God? Well, this is where it ties in to the entire series of what we've been talking about, faith. How do we get faith? We get it because we heard it from the Word of God. We accept it as truth. We release it. We feed it. And we let it lead us to what we think, what we say, and what we do. We can summarize it like this. You get faith by hearing it, accepting it, and living it. So how do I then put on the armor of God? It's the same process. You put on the armor of God by taking what you know about the armor and then living it in your life. Take what you know about truth. The Bible tells us, and we'll see that in a moment, Jesus, you don't have to put it on the screen yet, Jesus says the truth will make you free. You take what you know about the truth. You take what you know about righteousness. You take what you know about salvation, and you live it in your life. And what you are doing is you are clothing yourself. You are adorning yourself. You are equipping yourself with the entire armor of God through the knowledge of God's word. You see, knowledge, when it's used properly, wins battles. Think about all the different war stories. Think about all the different strategic battles throughout the history of human conflict. Knowledge, at its best, when it's used for the right purpose, wins battles. So when we take the understanding of the armor of God and apply it and live it, it begins to bring about victory in our lives. Whereas when you look on the other end of the coin, ignorance will never bring victory. Ignorance will never bring victory. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in the book of Hosea, Hosea in the 4th chapter, verse number 6, God speaking to his people, he says, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. You have rejected knowledge. I will reject you from being priest. Well, Pastor Luke, that's the Old Testament. God's no longer like that. Yes, you're right. God has given us grace through Jesus Christ. And look what Jesus says in John the 8th chapter. Jesus says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Can I ask you a question? What happens if you don't know the truth? How can you arm yourself or live it if you don't know it? Ignorance never brings about victory. Which places the importance on us, church, on you and I, to not let the Word of God be something that collects dust on our coffee tables. To not let the Word of God be something that we only get for 30 minutes on a Sunday morning. To not base our entire system of beliefs on a catchy song lyric, but rather to get into the Word of God in our own lives, to set time aside to read, to understand, to comprehend, to study, so that we would know. It's because knowledge, when it's used properly, produces victory. But ignorance will never bring about victory. So we got to understand that we cannot allow the Word of God to be something put to the side, because armor is great, but if armor going out to battle stays on the table, then it doesn't do any good in the fight. We have to put it on by taking what we know about the Bible. Well, you know, you might say, oh, I just don't feel like I'm a good person. The Bible says that I'm the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus. I don't know if I can do this. The Bible says that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Well, I don't know if I can live or operate in love. Well, the Bible says, Paul says that there's faith, hope, and love. The greatest is love. I got to live in love, and I can live in love. And you see, when we take what we know about the Word of God and we live it in our lives, we are putting ourselves into the armor of God, and therefore we can do exactly what Paul the Apostle said we could do, to stand. To stand in the evil day when 1,000 might fall on my right and 10,000 might fall on my left. To quench the fiery darts of the evil one. Or to withstand the wiles, the tactics, or the devices of the devil. Did you know that you and I don't have to be ignorant of how the devil works? I don't? Yeah. You don't. You can know how the devil works. I'm going to make a statement to you. The Bible tells us that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Can I make a follow-through statement? This is just my own statement. The devil is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The Bible tells us in the book of Revelation that the devil is locked up for 1,000 years, and when he's released, guess what he does? He goes back to doing exactly the same thing he was doing before. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us, we'll just go ahead and put it up on the overhead. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians, the second chapter, we are not ignorant of his devices. We know how the devil works. How do we do? How do we know? We have thousands of years of human and spiritual history right here in our fingertips through the Word of God. We can see through thousands of years of how people have succeeded or what people have done to fall at the hands of the devil. Can I summarize thousands of years of history to tell you how the devil works against you and myself so that we're not ignorant of his devices? Can I just summarize it real easily for you? The devil works with thoughts, ideas, and suggestions. Let's go back to the very beginning and think about this. The very beginning, Adam and Eve. They're in the garden, connected, united with God, and God says there's one tree, the tree of the knowledge of the fruit of good and evil, you cannot eat. And the devil takes the words of God and twists them to Eve. And he plants an idea in her mind that if she eats this fruit, she will be more like God. Who doesn't want to be more like God? So he planted the idea. She gave in, and we know sin in humanity. How about this? The Bible tells us in the book of John, in John the 8th chapter, the Bible tells us that, the book of John tells us that the devil had already planted to betray Jesus in Judas's heart. How about this? If you're familiar with the book of Acts in the 5th chapter, there's a story of a man and a woman named Ananias and Sapphira. They sold a plot of land, and they brought that plot of land to the feet of the disciples, but they withheld some of the profits of that land, and they lied about it, and they faced judgment where they dropped dead. They didn't drop dead because they withheld profits. They dropped dead. Peter says, "Why have you allowed the devil to fill your heart?" How does the devil fill our hearts? He can't just jump in and possess. Well, Pastor Luke, what about the possessed? I've seen the movie, the people, their head spins around and they climb up the walls and the priest comes running out because he's afraid. Just like God doesn't kick open the door of your life to overtake you, you've got to open the door to the thoughts, ideas, and suggestions. That's why God told Cain, sin knocks at your door. If you open the door to the thoughts, the ideas, and the suggestions of the devil, you begin to feed yourself and find yourself in a position of defeat. We're not ignorant of how he works. We know his devices. So with that, we can say that putting on the armor of God is to take what we know about the armor, to take what we know about truth and about righteousness and about salvation, about faith, about hope, about the Word of God, about the gospel of peace. To take what we know and to live it in our lives. Because this is where it gets very important for you and I. Are you ready? This is where it really gets heavy. The battle begins and ends with our thoughts. The battle begins and ends with our thoughts. That's why Jesus says to the men, men, if you look at a woman with lust in your eyes, you have already committed adultery in your heart. Jesus says, if you have an offense against your brother, you're already committing murder in your heart. Jesus tells us, don't worry about the speck in somebody else's eye. Worry about the plank in your own, because the battle begins and ends with our thoughts. And if we don't maintain our thought life, we'll find ourselves victims of the battle that comes our way. So we say, putting on the armor of God is taking what I know about the armor and living it. How about this? We'll take it one step further. Putting on the armor of God is taking what I know about the armor and living it and allowing it to maintain my thoughts. Putting on the armor of God takes what you know and maintains your thoughts by it. Faith essentially becomes, to you and I, a filter for our minds. We oftentimes think, if it's conduct, if I can just change my conduct, if I can appear or act like a better person, if I can create a new habit, my whole life will begin to follow suit and I will become a better person. But changing our conduct never brings about the life change that we need until we address the issue of our thoughts. And putting on the armor of God takes what I know about the armor and maintains my thoughts through it. Because the battle is not a physical battle. Taking a sword and whacking at the devil is not going to do anything. It's a spiritual battle in our lives. And it begins and ends with your thoughts. So faith becomes a filter. Because when the devil throws a dart at you, you're not worthy. You know that while I was still a sinner, Christ died for me. When the devil comes at you and says, you're a scoundrel, you mess up too many times, there's no way you'll ever be good enough for God, you can start to say, no, the Bible tells me that I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You can say, hey man, I can't do this, but the Bible says I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You say, man, I can't make it through this day. The Bible says that I will be able to stand and to withstand. Why? Because every dart, every idea, every suggestion that comes your way has to pass through the filter of your faith, what you believe, what you've accepted, and what you live, and now it becomes the armor that you bear. And in doing so, every attack, every device, every idea is filtered through your faith, your belief. You see, every week we've taken a foundation and put a brick. The next week we've added a brick on top of it and a brick, and we're building this foundation of our faith. And here we see that we've taken what we understand about faith and now we apply it to the spiritual battles of our lives by allowing faith to become a filter for our minds. And faith begins to take our thoughts captive. Your faith becomes a filter, taking your thoughts captive. How do I take my thoughts captive? Wonderful question. Because oftentimes what happens is our thoughts take us captive. Yes, so how do I take my thoughts captive if they're taking me captive? Well, it's real easy. You turn the tide of the fight because you put the armor of God on. You want to know how to take your thoughts captive? It's real easy. One word, attention. Attention. What you give attention to will grow in your life. That's why you can't watch for the guys in the house. You can't watch TV nowadays without seeing some symbolism of sex, whether it's in a commercial or the TV show or whatever it might be. You have a decision right there to allow that thought to take you captive or to take that thought captive. That's why when we're sitting on the couch watching the TV and if there's a commercial or a scene, my wife knows it goes to eye contact. Boom. I'm looking at you because I'm not going to allow this to take me captive. I'm going to look at what I'm already captivated by over here. Take those thoughts captive by giving attention to what you know about the armor of God and how you live it in your life. Faith becomes a filter. The book of 2 Corinthians, we'll finish with the verse on this. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 says this, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Once again, it's not a physical fight. It's not against the people. It's not against your husband. It's not against your wife. It's not against your neighbor or your boss. It's not against the people across the Atlantic Ocean in another land. The fight is not a physical fight. It's a spiritual fight. But mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. I love this next verse. It goes on and it says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself above the knowledge of God, taking every thought into captivity. How? Because it passes through the filter of your faith. And you give attention to the armor of God and not to the devices of the devil. But it goes even one step further by saying, verse number 6, being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Obedience is so simple. Obedience is living God's will. Don't you know it's God's will for you to know what the truth is? Don't you know it's God's will for you to know about righteousness? Don't you know it's God's will for you to know about salvation? Don't you know it's God's will for you to know the Word of God? Don't you know it's God's will for you to know and live faith? By taking what you know and living it, you're living in the will of God, living in obedience, and taking every thought captive in your life. How do you take the thoughts captive that take you captive? You give your attention to the Word of God, the armor of God, and what you know, and living it, letting it pass through the filter of your faith, and you will see the armor of God begin to succeed in your life. And now, like Paul says, you will stand. You will withstand the wiles of the devil. You'll stand in the evil day when everybody else is falling around, and you will see the fiery darts of the wicked one quenched in your life. Why? Because you have taken on the whole armor of God in your life. The devil's desire for you is to bring you to the same position as him. The Bible tells us that in his heart, he exalted himself above God. And because of that, he fell. And now his desire for you and I, because we, as Genesis tells us, were created in the image of God, his desire for you and I is to get us to believe the lie that God does not want us or we do not need him, so that we would share the same fate as him. But I'll tell you what, we've got the whole armor. The armor of truth, the armor of righteousness, the armor of faith, the armor of salvation, the armor of the Word of God, the armor of the gospel of peace, the armor of love, the armor of hope. And when we dress ourselves by taking what we have heard, accepted it as truth, and now live it like we've talked over the past 6 weeks, now we wear the armor of God and we find ourselves prepared to fight the fight and to live what the Bible says, that we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ, because the battle has already been won. It starts by wearing the whole armor of God. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Amen. God is good. It's exciting. I tell you, if you haven't missed or if you missed some of those faith series, go online. They're real easy. You can watch them. You can listen to them. Put them on your phone or listen to them during your commute. Over and over again, get this in you, because I believe when we live in faith, not only will we please God, but the Bible says we walk by faith, not by sight. And when we understand this walk of faith, man, it really begins to define who we are and what we do in our lives. Amen? Amen. Praise God. How about this? How about we honor the Lord this morning? Let's receive the tithe and the offering today. Can we do that? You know, it's such a worthwhile opportunity to get involved here at the house, to give into the kingdom of God. Your gifts go towards funding the gospel and giving and sharing the love of God to a lost and dying world. This is a worthwhile house to invest in. As a matter of fact, the laws of California changed over the last year, which forced us to make some decisions and have to do things. And your support enabled us to continue doing what we have done for years and to continue for the future of doing that. And I want to show that to you by way of a video. So draw your attention to the screen to see what your support brought to the church.
Each week, people from all over the Inland Empire come to The Rock and receive groceries from our food distribution center, absolutely free of charge. For some of these families, this is their only source of food. Every year, we truck in over 8 million pounds of food and drinks. In keeping with the new California trucking law, we were required to purchase a new tractor as well as a refrigerator trailer. Because of your generosity, we can continue to receive large amounts of food and bring it to our community. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in your tithes and offerings. Because of your giving, we can make a big impact in the lives of others.
Because of the emission laws in California, we had to not only get a new refrigerator because the unit would no longer get a certification. We actually had to buy a new truck too, which was not a bad thing because our old tractor, every time we went over the grapevine to pick up food in the Bakersfield, they would say that they'd have to get out of the tractor and put some oil on the truck and lay hands on it so that it would make it over the hill. So praise God, through your giving, through your support, this church is able to not only abide by the laws of our land, but also to continue feeding thousands of people every year for future years because you get involved. Hey, listen, before we leave, I just want to ask you, do me a favor real quick. Just give me a moment more of your time. Don't get up. Don't leave. Don't look at your phones or get your stuff together. Just give me a moment of your time and your attention because it's so important. I want to ask you a question, and I would like to ask you to answer it within your own heart. As honest as you can. Don't pat it, don't make it better than it is, because nobody's gonna know this answer except you and God. The question is this: if you were to leave today and you were to die, heaven forbid that be the case, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You say, man, I don't know. I don't know if I even believe in heaven or hell. I haven't quite landed on that yet. Did you know that just because you haven't seen it, because you haven't felt it, because you haven't experienced, doesn't mean it's not real? Heaven's a real place, hell's a real place. The Bible tells us about that. As a matter of fact, let me give you an illustration. You don't see or feel the radio waves right now going from me to the sound booth to my microphone's receiver, but yet you hear the sound of my voice because you know they exist. Heaven's a real place. Hell is a very real place. Say, you know, every day we wake up and we read on the article or we see in the news about somebody who woke up and thought that day was going to be a normal day in their lives, only to find themselves faced with eternity because they died when they didn't expect it. Don't let that be you today. So let's answer that question. What would happen to you? Well, you say, man, maybe I think, I hope, I wish. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can think, hope, wish, want, desire, have the most positive outlook on life, have the best thoughts towards life, means that you're going to get to heaven? Nowhere in the Bible can you find that because you have a desire to go to heaven, you're going to get there. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents took you to church as a child, because you were christened or baptized as a baby, because you went to Sunday school classes, because they brought you to churches on Christmas and on Easter, or even because they told you you were a Christian growing up. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can get to heaven because of those things? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you go to church now, you've got a gold star attendance record, you've even got a card in your wallet that says you're a member to a church. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible, because you're a member, because you go to church, nowhere in the Bible will you find you can get to heaven? We think oftentimes, well, I'm a Christian, you know, I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or any other type of world religion. As a matter of fact, I had a conversation with a young man that said exactly that to me. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because of a default system of classifications, that because you're not one thing or the next, that must mean that you're a Christian and therefore you're going to get to heaven? You can't get to heaven because of classification, because America's money says in God we trust. You can't get to heaven by default. Can't get to heaven because you served in church, because you worked in the children's ministry, or you sang in the choir. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that. Yet oftentimes we believe that's all we have to do is to pay our penance or to make our attendance good. Listen, let me tell you the truth. Nothing you and I can do on our own. We couldn't buy it. We can't earn it. We can't work for it. Nothing we could do on our own would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. Why? Because the Bible tells us that God's standard is perfection. But we have a problem. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, which means we can't make it on our own. Nothing you could do on your own would make you good enough to get into heaven. Think, if I'm a good person, well, if I give to the Red Cross or give some of my tax return to a charitable organization or try to help out people, good people go to heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. Nothing we could ever do on our own would ever make us good enough. So then how do we find ourselves in heaven? Can't do it your way or my way or some well-meaning church committee or author's way. The only way we can get there is God's way. And that way is Jesus Christ. Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. So today, let's not do it any other way but his way. The Bible, in the book of John, in the third chapter, Jesus is speaking to a religious man, a man who knew the Word of God, a man who lived it, but didn't take it one step further. And Jesus says to this man, Nicodemus, you must be born again. What does that mean? Does it mean what Hollywood and society or culture has made it out to be? Born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing in the eyes and the heart of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God. It's not about your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who God is. The Bible tells us that the devil in hell and the demons in hell know who God is and they even tremble, but they're not on their way to heaven. We saw that the devil himself could quote the scripture to Jesus, but we know that that's not good enough. It's not just about knowing who God is. I could say I know who the president is, but I do not know him personally. You could miss out on knowing God when his desire is for you to have a personal relationship with him through his son, Jesus Christ. Let me prove it to you. The last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to his church and he says, listen, he's coming back. Jesus says he's coming back, and when he comes back, he better find us hot or he better find us cold. Because if he finds us lukewarm, he goes on, he says he will vomit us from his mouth. Whoa, shocking statement. And what Jesus Christ is saying is that lukewarm Christians will be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. What does that mean to be lukewarm? Let's discuss that. Let's define that. Lukewarm simply means that you've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. You got some of the God or the church in you. You got some of the world in there. You're kind of doing your own thing on the rest of the week. And then on Sundays, you're doing your own thing. You're kind of teeter-tottering back and forth. You're riding the fence. That's an uncomfortable position to be in. And let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough today to tell you the truth that you're not gonna make it. Even if that rubs you the wrong way. God forgive us in American churches that we've watered the message down for so many years because we've been more interested in the number of people in our seats than the condition of the souls. But I love you enough to tell you the truth. You can't get to heaven your way. Can't get to heaven some well-meaning author's way. The only way we can do it is God's way, and that's through Jesus. Today I want to give you that opportunity. The Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Like any gift, it has to be accepted or rejected. You have the free will choice. God's not a manipulator, a conniver. He won't force his way in or make his way in. You've got to choose to accept the gift of God through eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and then on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. And when I do that, I want to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, today, I want to give my heart, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus said these words. He said, if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. But if you deny him, the Bible says, he will deny you before your Father. Today, it's your choice. You can make the decision, follow through, or you can sit there and do nothing. Because God's not going to manipulate. He's not going to force his way in. He's not going to push his way in. Listen, let's get a right understanding of who God is. He's not in heaven with a 2x4 waiting to whack you over the head because of what you've done. He's not like a kid on an anthill with a magnifying glass trying to burn you up so you come over to him. God loved you so much and he loved me so much that he gave Jesus Christ to die on a cross for us, for our sin, so that we could be reunited with him through his son Jesus. And it starts today by making that decision. Who should raise your hands if you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life? In just a moment, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. I'm a man. You can put it right back down from there. Who should raise your hands? Maybe you're not sure. Don't walk out of this place without making sure. Maybe you did this at the youth group or at a Harvest Crusade. Maybe you prayed that prayer once long ago, but you never really followed through with it today. Hey, today is the day for you to get your hand up, to make that decision and follow through it today. This is your day. Who should raise your hands? Maybe you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing. Maybe you've been running from God instead of to God. Listen, if that's you, come on, quit playing games with God. Stop messing around. And start accepting the gift that God has for you through Jesus Christ. Eternal life. And it's not just about what happens when you die. Jesus says, I have come to give you life more abundantly. It starts today by accepting and living in the gift that God has for you and I through his son, Jesus Christ. So wherever you're at in this auditorium, from the front to the back, from the side to the side, you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through. If you're outside in the foyer watching by television or the Love Rock Cafe, or even at home on the internet, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time. In just a moment, I'm going to count to three, and when I do, I want you to pop your hand up. I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, you can put it right back down, and we'll go forward together with your relationship with God. Listen, it doesn't matter what anything else is going on in this room. Don't think about the person to your left or to your right. What's most important right now is you and God. I don't care if you've been in this church for 26 years or 1 hour. Today is the day of your salvation, and it starts by making that decision. So I'm going to count to three. If that's you, in just a moment, get ready to put your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six. I see you. Seven. I see you right there. Anybody else in this place today? Seven wise people. Where are your hands at? Let me see your hands. I didn't see you yet. Everybody was over here. I see ushers. Eight. I got you right there. Eight wise people. I see the ushers pointing. Help me out here, ushers, so I can see them. Nine. I see you back there. Anybody else in this place today? Two back there or one? Three. 10, 11. I got you. I can count. Anybody else in this place today? 12. I see you right there. Say, man, I wonder if I should. This is your moment. Hey, this is your time. Don't let another moment pass you by from making the best decision of your life. Anybody else? Hey, I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Where are you at today in this place? You need to make that decision for Jesus Christ. Anybody else today? Praise God for the 12 or so wise people. Awesome. Here's what we're going to do. For those of you that raised your hand, or maybe you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, and you know you should have. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. If God's speaking to your heart right now, it's not too late, because here's what we're going to do. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to do something in just a moment. We're all going to stand together. As we do, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend. If you came with somebody or somebody brought you, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend. If you need a friend, get out of your chair. Get into the aisle and come meet me right here at the altar. We're going to change destinies together. You don't get saved by raising your hand and say, want to. Now it's time, like we talked about today, to accept it and to follow through by living it, to follow through with that decision you're making today. So wherever you're at, from the front row to the back row, wherever you're at, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, come meet me here at the aisle. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. Let's all stand together. Please don't leave when they come forward. That discourages them. But if you raise your hand, come on, get out of your seat. Come meet me right here, right now.
Just as you are. Here is beautiful.
You can come wherever you're at.
Just come, just as you are. Come and see. Come and see.
If that's you, come on.
Come and live forever. Life everlasting.
Congratulations. Good job. Congratulations. You can come today if that's you. Praise God. Hey guys, listen, today is a good day. You're making the best decision. This is big. That a human being can ever make. Awesome job. You're not going to a funeral, you're going to a birthday celebration. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. Here's what I wanna do. I wanna introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. Here's what he's gonna do. He's gonna take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. Look it, I got a sword on the stage. I mean, you made it through me, I'm as weird as it's gonna get, okay? Nothing weird goes on. He's gonna lead you in a prayer to ask Jesus to come into your heart, to invite him into your life to be the Lord and Savior. What does that mean? The leader of your life. Secondly, he's gonna give you some real free information, real easy to read, 20 minutes just to help point you in the right direction. So when you walk out of this building, you say, what do I do next? We're gonna help set you in that right direction. The last thing he's gonna do is he's gonna invite you back to come hang out with us. We want to get you connected with a friend here at church, somebody that will meet with you right before church to buy you a cup of coffee, sit down with you, teach you some things about the Word of God for a couple of weeks, not a long time, it's not a big commitment, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in all that God has for you. So if you would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer, of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.